coming on video cassette.
Come on, Marty!
They're back, and they've saved the best for last.
Where'd you learn to shoot like that?
7-Eleven.
Michael J. Fox, Christopher Lloyd, Mary Steenburgen. Back to the Future Part 3, coming on video cassette November 8th.
Come along with me, celebrate year 3. It's Marchy McFly again. Back to the Future 3, a month-long podcast with me. It's Marchy McFly. It's Marchy McFly again. I'm doing it again. I couldn't stay away, I confess. Another adventure with Marty and Doc, and this time they're in the OS. So come along with me, celebrate year 3. It's Marchy McFly again. Stay here all month long and get sick of this song, 'cause it's Marchy McFly. It's Marchy McFly again. It's a 31-day podcast where I celebrate one movie, and the movie happens to be Back to the Future Part 3.
It's Thursday, it's Thursday, it's Thursday, March 9th. It's the 9th month of Marchy McFly. And tonight I'm talking about Back to the Future Part 3 that I watched today for the 9th consecutive time. Thank you for joining me. I'm not sure what I have planned tonight. I know a few things I want to talk about, but yes, ladies and gentlemen, it is Thursday night. And for the 9th time in a row this month, Marchy McFly 3, I watched Back to the Future Part 3. And here I am talking to you about Back to the Future Part 3 again. And it's funny because two of the things I want to talk to you about do not take place in the Old West. They're mostly focused on the first movie. as we see in this movie, 1885 is the beginning of Hill Valley as we know it. I mean, it's been around for a while, but now they're really, they have a courthouse, they have a clock tower. And I don't mean to turn Marchy McFly into a Mayor Goldie Wilson bashing party, but as we see in the original Back to the Future, Mayor Goldie Wilson wanted to replace the clock tower in 1985. The clock tower that was built in 1885. Do you see where I'm going here? He should not be trying to replace this clock tower. He should be celebrating it. He should be working with that woman who wanted to save the clock tower. They should be putting all their efforts into the fact that it is the 100th anniversary of the clock tower, and yet that is never mentioned by Mayor Wilson. All he cares about is his re-election campaign. He doesn't care about, you know, dead terrorists in mall parking lots. He doesn't care about, I don't even know, where is he in the alternate 1985? I don't know, but I do know that he doesn't care about a clock tower. He doesn't care about homeless guys, you know, sleeping out in the middle of downtown. That downtown area was like real crap, and yet 100 years earlier, the mayor celebrated the clock tower by having an extravaganza, and he thought to himself, you know, for years and years, this clock tower will be a marvel of Hill Valley. It will really be what puts us on the map, having our own giant courthouse. And what it will really do is kind of be a central area, a meeting area, really a hub of not only democracy and justice, but also a hub of a city for hundreds and hundreds of years. Now, somewhere along the line, Hill Valley got their stuff together. I'm going to guess it's when the Wilsons got out of politics and got into hover conversions, okay? Because in the future, you have a beautiful courthouse with all this beautiful glass. Now, of course, you know, some local ruffians smashed through it. But back in 1985, they didn't give one crap or two craps about that clock tower. The clock tower that meant so much, so very much in 1885. They had a train. It came in on a train. That's how special it was. Now, another thing I want to talk about, actually, this just popped in my head now because I've thought about it, but I haven't discussed it. At the celebration, the 1885 celebration, the mayor kind of christens the clock and it starts working on the ground. Like the clockworks are going and it is starting to keep time. So they have to get it up into the clock tower. They lift it into the clock tower while it's working. Is that a normal thing? I feel like they wouldn't have just done that, right? But it does seem odd to me. Like, why wouldn't it, why wouldn't they get the clock in place and then start it when it's in the actual clock tower instead of starting it on the ground? And then, okay, now we got to make sure we don't mess it up. Otherwise, our time is off. But what it did do was allow for the clock to be working in the background in the bar. So it really, it plays a part in the movie because when Doc drinks that one shot of whiskey, passes out, and the bartender, is it Clarence? I forget. Chester. Him and Joey make the wake-up juice. You can see the clock in the background. He's like, it's going to take about 10 minutes for him to wake up. And Marty's able to look over his shoulder and see the clock right there. Because, you know, 8 a.m. is when Mad Dog and his boys are showing up. They're riding into town. And seeing that clock right there is a nice visual. Plus, the clock tower is such an iconic part of Back to the Future, the original. You know, having it, not I wouldn't call it a character, but it is prominent in all three movies. The lightning strike is seen in all three movies. Having it kind of right there is also just cool because it fits into the narrative of Back to the Future trilogy. Another thing I want to talk about before I even get to the second thing that I was thinking about was, and I may have discussed this before, but one thing I notice is that, you know, Back to the Future 3 is so much more like Back to the Future than Part 2 is. Like, Back to the Future Part 2 is like, it's an anomaly as far as in the trilogy, if you go by the formula. And maybe that's a good thing. You don't want all these movies to be the same. But Back to the Future 3 really keeps this kind of these beats that the first movie has. Obviously, all three of them have Marty waking up to Leah Thompson, different versions of her. All three of them have a chase outside of a store, a cafe. All three of them have Tom Wilson character barging in and calling McFly, actually in all three of them, McFly, and you're not Seamus McFly. You look like him though. But what the third movie, maybe they all kind of have the same beat, but one of the things that the third movie has that I was like, oh my God, this is completely, you know, back to the first movie is a love interest showing up at Doc's. In the original, the love interest is actually Lorraine. So she thinks she's a love interest when Marty knows that's his mama. But she shows up and they're like, quick, cover the DeLorean. and they let her in right after they were testing the model. Of course, we have the model. That's the same, or not the same, but that, you know, that harkens back. Right after the model, we have, isn't that right? After the model is when Lorraine shows up, and right after the model is when Clara shows up. They cover it. And they have to kind of talk to each other. They have to talk to the person for a minute while someone stands in the background. In Back to the Future, it's Doc in the background. In one of my favorite scenes in the movie, like just the way he kind of, you know, shrugs. It's so underrated as far as like a memorable moment. You think of, you know, you remember Lorraine being there, but Doc's kind of his acting in that, his reaction is wonderful. Wonderful. I'm trying to think, were there other things? Obviously, there's, you know, the race to time, the getting back to the future, that race, like you have a specific amount of time and you have, not that you're on a clock, but you have to time it just right. And, you know, in the original, obviously you have to get the stroke of the lightning strike to line up perfectly. In this, you have to make sure you get up to 88 before you go over the bridge, before you don't, or fly into, Shonash Ravine, never to be called Clayton Ravine in the years to come, to be called Eastwood Ravine. And I wonder, now I'm thinking about it, you know, Doc and Clara don't go back, okay? I assume they stay around for years. Doc either goes to prison and then and makes amends for stealing the train. But I wonder if Doc had anything to do with, no, I would think most of the town probably never see them again, never realize that Doc and Marty are the ones who stole the train, and they just named the ravine after Clint Eastwood because of his taking out the Mad Dog Griffin and his gang of no good doers. No gooders? I don't know. Isn't there a word? The bunch of no good, I don't know. They're no good. What the hell was I even talking about? Oh, why was it named Eastwood Ravine? Did Doc have anything to do with that? He didn't need to. But yeah, I often wonder, how long did Doc stay? I think Jules and Vern were born and partly raised in the Old West, and then Doc got the train to work, and then they started traveling all over the place, probably freaking out the kids for a while. I'd like to think that's what happened. He went right to the future, got the Hubbard conversion, then he went back to get Einstein and see Marty. Otherwise, it seems like, God, how long have they been traveling and they waited all this time to see Marty? Like, why didn't, not that it makes a difference to Marty, because Marty could have seen them, you know, Marty just got back, so he's seeing them right away. But if he's like, huh, Doc, you lived a long and happy life and you never thought about me once, so I'd like to think it took years for Doc to create his new time machine, and in doing that time, that's when he had his family, which I've talked about already. But guess what? This is 9 days into a 31-day event, so get used to there being repeats and regurgitations. But this one that I've been thinking about. Before I go to this. They timed it perfectly for the train to push. And I actually love this ending. Like, the more I watch it, the more I'm like, that is, like, it is a big, exciting ending. And the horse riding, the jumping off the stuff. I mean, there are stuntmen in there, but they do a kind of a seamless, great job of making the actors and the stuntmen work, you know, seem like they're the same person without the need. There's no CGI, but you know, they they get to the train just in time. Think about this. they're like in this major rush to get to the train. You know, they take out Mad Dog and they're like, come on, we got to go. But then he stops. He's like, oh, I'll take my gun and I'll give it to Seamus. He'll trade it for a hat. Take care of that baby. And then Michael J. Fox like pulls that horse and goes. I mean, he does a great job of riding this horse. But they get to the train. They commandeer it. They right away. But where they get it, they're like not that far away from the switch. If they miss the switch, their plan is off. They have to rethink. And how many times can you steal a train? Now you could say, okay, ladies and gentlemen, I want to show you the marvels of time travel. I'm going to steal this train and show you something you've never seen before. But that would screw with everyone's mind. They'd have to steal a train again. You know, you say they only get one chance, but no, they don't. They get one chance to push the DeLorean off, but if they don't even get that far, they could wait. Live a little while in 1885. But they get to the train, they steal it, they slow it down right before the switch, then they make the switch. Then they separate the engine, and they go on the new track, the straight track. Why did they put the DeLorean where they put it? First of all, how did they even make that thing? I guess Doc had a wagon, and he bent the... He made this, or maybe that is a wagon that you use to put those smaller train carts onto a train track. So they just use that for the DeLorean. There's a lot of like, how do they get there and how strong are these horses that pulled all this stuff? But, you know, when they put the train, the DeLorean on the tracks, it looks cool. But the semantics or, you know, the details of how they got that and how they figured that, how they were able to, you know, transport it, I guess with just horses is, you know, I just have to try to look the other way. But when they put the train on the track, why didn't they put the DeLorean back maybe 100 more yards or 200 more yards? Like, I know they needed a perfectly straight stretch of track, but when they're setting that up on the track, they could have moved back more. It just would have given the train more time. I mean, who knows? They could have given the train so much time that someone could have stopped the train. Like, or, it, you know what I mean? Like, it wouldn't have been 88 miles per hour or bust. Right now, it's 88 miles per hour. And if, you know, if they don't get it right at 88, the DeLorean's falling into the gorge with the train. Whereas if, you know, it just would have given them more length to work with. I guess you could say, I'm trying to argue both ways because I'm a giant nerd. There was a turn there that it wasn't long enough, or this was the best spot for there to be no one noticing it. Maybe there's land, someone's has a homestead over in their area, and they'd be able to see the DeLorean. I don't know. You could definitely just have moved it back 100 yards, 200 yards, and I think it would have behooved the scientists, and it would have just given them a little more space because they didn't have any space. Now in the first movie, you have the lightning strike. You don't have any space. You have to be perfect. In this movie, they made themselves have to be perfect, but they didn't have to be perfect. So now I want to jump to the other thing that I wanted to talk about and haven't gotten to. And that brings us back to the beginning of this movie, but also brings us back to the original Back to the Future. Marty writes Doc a letter, tells him that he will be shot in 1985. And when they're in the clock tower, Doc is like, before they're at the clock tower, Doc takes the letter and rips it up. Marty says, I have to tell you about the future. I have to tell you about your future. But he can't. He has to leave. He goes off and he gets in the DeLorean and the rest is history. Doc finishes up. He goes, ah, ha, ha. He's excited. He cleans up everything and he looks at the letter on the ground, you assume. And he goes, ah, what the hell? And he cuts all the letter pieces, takes them home, tapes them up, and learns all about his future. And then I'm going to talk about one other thing that is bugged me. One thing that really bugs me in this movie every time I watch it. But he takes the letter, he puts it back together, and waits 30 years. But in Back to the Future Part 3 and 2, the DeLorean goes off to 1985, and future Marty comes back. And he's like, you gotta, I'm back from the future. Doc passes out. Doc does not get a chance to get this letter. So that Doc, you would assume, is going to go on to get shot by the Libyans. There's no discussion of it. Doc, unless it comes up at some point, obviously I'm being ridiculous even thinking about it. But it crossed my mind because you watch these things and you look at paradoxes, I guess. Like in the book, in the novelization, you know, it's like, how come Doc doesn't remember that Marty came back in 1955 and that he sent him back to the Old West? And they make it seem like once it happens, that Doc does start to remember. Like the memories get fed into his head. They weren't always there, but when the time changes, the memories change. That was in the novelization. It's never discussed in the book, in the movie. So to me, it technically doesn't count, but I like reading. It's almost like another person's account. How would you tell the story? That's why I'm enjoying the novelization. But just the fact that there was a letter that was so important, so integral, however you like to say it, to Doc surviving in 1985, and it is seemingly forgotten about when Marty comes back from, you know, fixing the whole Gray Sports Almanac. It's a tiny thing, but at the same time, in the history of Back to the Future, it's actually kind of a massive thing that isn't important at all. You know, it's not like, oh no, I found the loophole and I found the goof. And I wonder if that's listed in the goofs. You know, I thought of this myself. I didn't look this up. I didn't see this written anywhere, but I'm going to see if it's in the goofs or in the trivia or anything, or if there's any mention or reference to it. And I haven't seen any mention or reference to it in the novelization. One thing I was thinking about was I read the part, I've already gotten to the part where he and Clara have met each other, and it's right before Clara shows up with the telescope. But I was wondering if they would say, while they were looking at the map, if they would say they didn't see behind them, the school teacher also got off the train. They didn't mention that in the book. But again, that's one of those things that blew me away when what culture showed it in the video. That Clara was there the whole time. What was I still talking about? The note? Oh, just the note and kind of how that was missed and seemingly forgotten about in this third movie. It was forgotten about in the second movie, I guess, but it didn't have time. Like, it could have showed, and maybe it, now the letters that Marty had drawing were just the letter from Western Union from 1885, Doc. So I don't know. I can't believe I had two things to talk about, and I can't believe I've already, 20-something minutes in. There's one other thing that popped in my head that I want to talk about. And, you know, Doc didn't want to know too much about his future. That's why he ripped up the letter. Then he said, what the hell? He continuously doesn't want to know too much about his future, except he keeps learning about his future. I forget if I discussed this already, but there's a scene where Doc, you know, comes back from spending the night with Clara. Let's be honest. They probably probably had coitus there. Is that the old fashioned way of saying it? I don't know. They probably knew each other in the biblical sense. Maybe they were two grown adults. Doc is all, you know, whistling Dixie and all happy, and he sees the gun belt around Marty, and he's like, you're not still going through it. He's like, no, I'm going back to the future with you tomorrow on Monday. But, just in case, I want to be ready. They see the headstone. It's still being created, even though Doc's name is not showing up on it. The headstone is still there. And He's like, what do you want to do? I goes, you know, oh, you need to be take this seriously. And they talk, that's when the guy comes up and measures him for the coffin. He goes, you could be the one who dies. And he's like, he says something about, I'm not afraid of anything. But yeah, maybe he says that later when he's with the, when he's at the, or but he says that earlier when he's at the party talking to the Colt. Is it the Colt? Samuel Colt, the guy with the gun. But Doc mentions this is the same kind of hot-headedness that got you in your accident. And he goes, what accident? He goes, oh, I shouldn't have said anything. He's like, what accident, Doc? He's like, no, you know too much already. Doc lives on knowing too much about his future. For a guy who doesn't want to know too much about his future, he didn't care about bringing Marty to 2015 and learning that far into his future. Oh, we want you to learn about your two kids. You have a kid that looks just like you. No problem you knowing about that. No problem you knowing about your daughter. No problem you knowing about, you know, 2015. That's not a problem. But if you know, hear about a car accident that completely changes your trajectory in life, oh, no. That's where I draw the line. Even after mentioning it, even after the fact that Marty goes back to 1885, Doc reads this letter. Doc learns that Clara exists before Clara even knows Doc exists. Doc knows that he's going to be shot. Doc knows, like, all these things about his future, and he can't tell this kid, this child who traveled 70 years in the past to save him, the other version of him, like, you know, I don't know how good of a, like, it's almost like delinquent of responsibility saying, yes, 17-year-old child, go back 70 years and save me, please. You know, I can't, why don't we get a third person involved? Someone maybe a little older, a little more mature, someone who, you know, or go back with him. Just go back with him and hide. I mean, you talk about you can't meet yourself. Well, you met yourself by the weather experiment. That didn't bother you, Doc. So not telling him about his accident really, really annoyed me. And then he's like, he says, well, Marty, you got to do what you got to do, and I got to do what I got to do. He literally says that, and it's almost like, hey, it is what it is. I can't tell you what I know, even though you've risked your life. You've left your family. You're a friggin' high school senior. You've risked your life multiple times for me. I can't tell you to not get in a car accident on October 26th, 1985. I can't tell you that. So let's go. Let's hang out. Let's go, you know, back to setting up. And they don't discuss it. And then the next thing you see is they're putting the DeLorean on the train tracks. It just, for a movie that, you know, for a character that I adore, for a performance that is fantastic, that scene annoys me every time. And maybe it's just like, I think it's just poorly, just a poorly written, the fact that they would even do this. Like, I don't know if Doc would do that, but just having that as Doc's response is just, to me, that's not how I think he would. I think after everything he's done, the least he could do is, tell him about the friggin' car accident. Now, here's the thing. Maybe that was in the back of Marty's mind. Probably not. I think his realization that it's okay to be afraid and it's okay to not listen to everything, because of Seamus, and Seamus talking about is his brother, Martin, that eventually is what saved Marty. Doc could have saved Marty. Instead, Marty's own kind of maturing saved Marty. And then he's like, Doc, I mean, this thing showed that Marty was fired, but it disappeared. And Doc's like, of course it did. I guess Doc does know, because Doc's been to the future. Doc's seen the new version of Marty. He's seen what Marty turns into. But he won't. He says, I've already been there. You're telling me he didn't look up Marty once to see the Marty that didn't get in the car accident? Because, I'm wondering if he came right from the future. I don't know. But I'd like to think that he saw the version that Marty didn't get in the car accident, because he didn't. And he's like, of course, the future is what you make of it. Yeah, okay. But, you know, Doc, I almost drove in the car accident. I kind of wanted to do it. You could have told me. Was that the accident? Please tell me that was the accident. Because now Marty's like, maybe that wasn't the accident. Maybe I always did that. Maybe there is an accident. I don't know. That bugged me. And oh my God, I think I'm done. Again, no notes. I was going to look up the IMDb trivia today. And here I am rambling on and on and realizing, I can save that for another day. Thank goodness, because after today, I still have 21 more days of Marchy McFly to enjoy, to celebrate, and to pontificate. I think that's a word for talking. I don't know. But my friends, I am out of here. So happy Thursday, everybody. I will be back again tomorrow. I have tomorrow off. It is one of those, I think I mentioned this earlier in the week, I work in higher ed, and because it's spring break, they gave us employees, staff, the Monday and Friday off. So I had a 3-day work week, which commenced today, and now I'm on another 3-day weekend. But then next week comes, and hopefully by the end of next week, my wife returns to work from her back surgery. She's excited about that. As am I. I would like to be able to afford groceries again, and she'd go a long way in helping with that. I'm kidding. I have groceries galore. I'm going to open up a Fresca right now and live a wild, wild life. Okay, my friends, I'm done. The rambling is complete. That once you know I start kind of just rambling incoherently, that means that the end of the show is right around the corner. And here it comes. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Geek Mentality. The Facebook page is fans.experts. The website is fans.experts.com. The podcast is Geek Mentality. And yep, that's it. I'm done. So until tomorrow, my friends, thank you for listening. Thank you for following. Thank you for subscribing. And here is my theme song.
This is my podcast. I made it. Geek Mentality's what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe. 'Cause I'm kinda funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time. And I'm kinda handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. At least listen to this episode.
Fans Not Experts.